everyone. Hope you're having a great day so far. Wanted to hop on today and talk to you about stewarding the gifting that God has given you. And I want to look at the parable of the talents today out of Matthew 25 verses 14 through 30. But before we dig into that, I want to tell you guys that just because you don't have one of the traditional gifts that we typically see in the body of Christ, like maybe singing or teaching, or maybe you're not called to be a pastor, maybe you're not called to be an evangelist, you know, whatever it is, doesn't mean that your gift isn't just as important to the body of Christ. It's extremely important. Have you guys ever gotten hurt before and lost the ability to really use one of your body parts? You really notice how important that part is whenever that happens to you, right? I was moving a few months ago and I fell during the move, and I really, really hurt my leg and my hip on my left side, and man, I noticed it so bad when I could not use that. It hurt like the dickens trying to go up the stairs. It was just horrible, horrible. And so we notice, right? We notice when we hurt something how valuable it is to our body, and God created every part of the body with a purpose. I want to tell you guys that your gift is a part of the body of Christ. Have you guys ever noticed that God didn't give one person all the gifts? He does that purposefully because we need each other. We are called to be the body of Christ, to depend on one another, to build each other up. And we need someone who has different talents, different capabilities from us to contribute, because that's what makes up the body of Christ. Imagine that everyone was a teacher, okay? And let's say that that represented an eyeball in the body of Christ. How well would that body function if it was a bunch of eyes and we didn't have ears and noses and hands and feet and whatever else that we needed in the body? Well, we'd have a lot of instruction going on, but nothing getting done, right? You know? And so that's why we need everyone's talents. And just because your talent doesn't fit the traditional mold doesn't mean that it's not super important. So let me give you an example of a true story that I've heard of from a church recently. So there was a guy who, he couldn't sing, he didn't really teach, he didn't really fit the mold for any of the traditional activities where you could go to serve at the church, and he was just brokenhearted because he was looking through the life group, the Sunday school list, didn't see anything that was good. You know, he just felt really, really out of place. And God spoke to his heart and said, "What are you good at?" And he was a carpenter in his day trade. That was kind of what he did. And he said, "Well, God, I do this, but there's nothing in the church related to this." And God was like, "Why don't you go to your pastor and see if there's a need for anything that you could help out with on the side?" And so he did. He went to his pastor and he said, "Hey, I know this may not be a thing, but I thought I'd throw it out there just in case." He goes, "I'm willing to help. I do this as my day job kind of a thing. Is there anywhere where I could contribute?" And the pastor thought about it for a second. He said, "You know, we might actually have a couple of elderly couples and some widows that are kind of more homebound now at the church, who I know that they live alone in their houses. They're kind of needing some attention." He goes, "Let me go check on that and I'll get back to you." So sure enough, this guy was able to go, and he had a ministry of just talking to these people who are lonely in their homes, and he would show up and he would fix things for them in their homes, and it turned out to be this huge ministry. And it turns out other guys ended up getting involved, and it turned out to be an official ministry at the church. They turned it into kind of a life group where they would go out and just help people on the side, you know, and the pastor and people at the church would kind of give direction on, "Hey, this person needs help," or whatever. And so they would go out and do this. And then it also turned into the pastor needed some help at the church, and so they would help with different projects there. And the pastor ended up going to this guy and saying, "You have no idea how badly we needed this," because the church was kind of falling apart in some different areas. There were different things going on. And he said, "I am so glad you spoke up and took the initiative." And so from day one, when he asked initially, look how much that gift multiplied and what a valuable contribution it was to his community. Imagine if he had just stayed silent. Imagine if he had just said, "Well, my gift is worthless. There's nothing that I can do. I don't sing. I don't teach. I don't fit this traditional mold. I don't really want to do parking crew. I don't really want to help greet people as they come in the door. There's nothing that I can do." Imagine if he took that attitude, you guys. And so I want to tell you guys, if your gift doesn't fit the traditional mold, don't ever count yourself out. You know, I have a friend who, she's a graphic designer, and she does incredible work. And so what she does to kind of help the church on the side is she'll make t-shirts for events for them. You know, she'll do these beautiful backdrops for events, and she'll just go and just pour her heart out and use that graphic design talent to contribute to her church in a powerful way. Now, is that one of the traditional churchy gifts? No, it's not. And yet it is so powerful and so needed for the church. And isn't it amazing that she's using that gift? You guys, we've got to get this in our heads to use our talents, but not only to use our talents, but to multiply those talents. So let's read some scripture today. Again, this is Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30, and it says, "For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted them to his property." Think of that as Jesus calling you. Verse 15, "To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, each according to his ability." Let's pause there for a second. Have you guys ever gotten jealous of somebody and their talent? Maybe they got a 10 and you got a 2 in terms of your ability. Maybe they are a vocalist and you're a vocalist, and when they sing, it's like it never gets pitchy and it's awesome and it's just phenomenal. And you're pretty good, but you know, you struggle some days and you're not like completely out there. Listen to me. It doesn't matter, because God gave you according to your ability. And I've known people in my life who maybe they were given a 2. Maybe they weren't given quite as much as that person who was given the 10. But because they stewarded it correctly, they ended up higher and bigger and multiplying that thing more than the person with the 10 because of their faithfulness. So don't ever discount yourself or compare yourself like that. Amen. God gave you exactly what you need. All right, let's continue. Verse 16. He who had received 5 talents went at once and traded with them, and he made 5 talents more. So also he who had the 2 talents made 2 talents more. But he who had received the 1 talent went and dug it in the ground and hid his master's money. Let's pause there for a second, okay? Think of that as the person who maybe they're a fantastic vocalist, but they never get involved in the choir at church. They never get involved on worship team. And they just kind of sit in the congregation and don't do anything with their gift. That's what this is talking about, okay? Let's keep going. Verse 19. "Now after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came forward bringing 5 talents more, saying, 'Master, you have delivered 5 talents. Here, I have made 5 talents more.' His master said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master.' And he who had the 2 talents came forward, saying, 'Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here, I've made 2 talents more.' His master said, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master.' He also who had received 1 talent came forward and said, 'Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and I hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours.' But his master answered him, 'You wicked and slothful servant, you know that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested money with the bankers, and at my coming, I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to those who have 10 talents. Ouch. Have you guys ever thought about that? Let's pause there. So the guy who did not multiply his talent or act on the gifting that God had brought into his life, he goes, "I'm going to take what I have given to you and I'm going to go put it into the person who is already multiplying their talent." Because guess what? God's going to multiply his kingdom regardless. That's just the way God works. You know, I heard from an author one time that they were supposed to write a book. Like, God gave them the exact title. He put that call in their life. He did everything like that. And they were like, okay, well, you know, they kind of let time slip away. They never really moved forward on it. And all of a sudden, they were walking through the bookstore a couple years later, and they saw their exact book that they were supposed to write with the exact title that God had given them. And they were furious. They went, "God, this person went and wrote my book." And God said, "Yes, they did." And they were furious, and they said, "God, how could you allow them to do that? That was supposed to be my book." And God said, "I gave you the opportunity to write that book, but you didn't steward the talent that that was given to you, and my will was going to be done regardless on this earth." And the person went, You guys, I want to tell you, it is so important that we steward and that we multiply the gifts that God has given us, because if he doesn't use you, he's going to go find somebody else. His will get accomplished on this earth. All right. Verse 29, "For to everyone who has more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But for the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So I want to tell you guys today, it is so important that we not only steward the gifts that God has given us, but that we multiply the gifts that God has given us. You know, God views faithfulness not just in terms of stewarding over that thing well that he's entrusted to us, but multiplying it. Notice in this scripture, the talents for Jesus to say, well done, good and faithful servant, they didn't just have to steward over what they were given and to keep it safe, quote unquote. They had to use it. They had to multiply that talent for Jesus to look at them as being in right standing. And so I want to encourage you guys today, maybe your gift doesn't fit the traditional churchy mold of what you've thought about. But think of it, you might be a finger, you might be a toe, you might be an elbow, an arm, whatever. We need every single gift. We don't just need the teachers and the singers and all this stuff that you traditionally think of. We need you, ladies and gents, because the body does not function well without your contribution and your gift. Hope you guys have a great day. I'll talk to you soon.